Ascent Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Brainhacker. Master memory, focus, emotions, and more to unleash the genius within. By Dave Farrow. Narrated by Michael Butler Murray. Publisher's note. This book is for informational purposes only. It is not intended to serve as a substitute for professional medical advice. The author and publisher specifically disclaim any and all liability arising directly or indirectly from the use of any information contained in this book. A healthcare professional should be consulted regarding your specific medical situation. Any product mentioned in this book does not imply endorsement of that product by the author or publisher. This is real. The strategies you're about to read have been tested by thousands of students. The events are real, although some events have been dramatized, combined, or edited for improved readability. Some names have been changed for privacy, but these people know who they are. Introduction. How to use this book. You probably picked up this book because you heard about my journey from ADHD and dyslexic kid with chronic pain to Guinness record holder for memory, and beyond. When I struggled with these challenges, everyone told me, there's no manual to run the brain. Not anymore. The goal of Brainhacker is to be the manual for your brain, or at least, the first volume in the journey. In this book, I intend to show you how to unlock the superhuman abilities we all possess. Examples include memorizing any amount of information, triggering perfect focus at will, learning 8 times faster than anyone else, speed reading, stopping self-sabotage, ending food cravings, truly fighting age-related mental decline, editing your own habits, lip reading. We start simple and then stack skills Voltron-like to form amazing complex powers. Each hack is then summarized at the end of the chapter. But I want this to be more than a list of tricks. I've included many stories of my life here, and I want you to follow along with my process of learning or creating hacks, and then apply my hacks to your life. But I want you to be empowered to make your own brain hacks too. That's right. I am not the guru with all the answers. I think I can help you solve a great many things with what I know. But what is more powerful is learning the process of making hacks yourself. In fact, let's start right now with our first brain hack. Stories help us remember and understand difficult concepts and new information, which is another reason why I have included many moments of my life here. Stories help us to experience the concepts rather than just get a summary of the bullet points. The story hack. Stories help make the lessons stick and show you how to make new brain hacks yourself. If you skip the story and jump right to the summaries of the hacks, you miss out on how the brain hack was created, and that context helps us learn. Humans are storytelling creatures for a reason. Learning through stories works because your brain is given context and can imagine the events in a personal, highly memorable manner. And that is your first brain hack. Your journey has begun. Axiom 1. The body-mind connection. Nearly every action in the body influences the brain. When our mind is stuck in patterns, blanking out, overtired, hyperactive, or emotional, it can be impossible to think your way out of anything. Instead, hack your brain by moving your body. 1. The body-brain hack. I can never spell dyslexia without looking it up. I have a theory that when they named this condition, they made it hard to spell on purpose, as a cruel joke on us. Think about it. How many words have an X in the middle? When they labeled me ADD-ADHD, they knew what they were doing, though. It's only a few letters. Perfect. If you don't have any attention span to speak of. as I sat in the dining room in my pajamas, trying my best to motivate my 6.5-year-old son to read. I couldn't help but feel silly. I was known for being a Guinness record holder for memory, a CEO, a brain expert, and a best-selling author. The person who turned ADHD and dyslexia into advantages. And yet, at that moment, I would be thrilled if I could get my son to pay attention for 5 seconds. Being a dad is my favorite role, but on this day, it felt like a chore. We were sitting at the table and looking down at phonics flashcards. And for the last 10 minutes, we'd been working on sounding out the words. Yet it wasn't going well. Lex couldn't stop goofing around, or so I thought. And when I couldn't take it any longer, I snapped. "Lex, you know how to sound this out, so why are you goofing around so much?" I held the card up to his face. "I'm trying, but I don't know." He paused, and we both looked up as my wife entered the room. When I turned back to him, I saw that the clowning face was broken as a single tear slid down his cheek. Moments later, he couldn't hold it back, and the tears flowed. I dropped the card and pulled him into a hug. "Buddy Boo, what is it?" I asked, feeling like a royal ass at that moment. He continued to cry as he wrapped his legs and arms around me, as any vulnerable 6-year-old would. I held on and waited patiently until he caught his breath. "I'm trying to focus," he sniffed, "but it's hard. I don't know, but if it's a B sound or a D sound, it changes in my head." In between gasps, he pointed at the flashcard I had thrown down. "Bottle." My gut tensed with pain. I had to overcome ADHD and dyslexia challenges as a child. Heck, as an adult, I'd lectured on it, coached, and guided thousands of students on how to turn that challenge into an advantage. But this was the first time it had ever hit so close to home. In that moment, I realized my son was maybe too much of a chip off the old block. "You mean you reverse the letters in your head?" I asked. "No, I'm reading forward, not like in reverse," he replied, shaking his head at me. "Duh." With that, the tension broke. His adorable response threw me into a fit of laughter, and Lex followed along, even though he didn't know why. It felt good. After the brief laugh, though, his sad face returned. His shoulders were hunched forward, sulking, while looking down. "Let's change gears," I told him. I stood up and took a deep breath and prompted him to follow along. I mimed a soldier marching with my head held high. We puffed out our chests and held our chins up. I even made a goofy face, and it got a laugh. "When you feel emotional or sad," I explained, "your body will follow your brain and start to withdraw from the world." I explained how his body was slumped forward, and his head was down, looking at the ground. This posture told his brain to stay sad. But it goes both ways. If we want to feel better, we can shake off these bad feelings by moving our bodies. After a few minutes of standing and smiling, my son was feeling better, but was still fidgeting a bit. Changing how your body moves can instantly shift moods and emotions in the brain. But if we want bigger change, we need to balance brain chemistry. Happy brains, please stand up. The Smile Brain Hack. Our minds and bodies are connected so closely that our thoughts influence our heart rate, blood pressure, and even immune response. The reverse is also true. By simply smiling or laughing, we can lower blood pressure and better fight disease. This mind-body connection was once thought of as a pseudoscience, but it is now an established fact. Subjects who are simply told to laugh, smile, or change posture on a daily basis have shown surprising mental and health improvements, from lowering depression, raising test scores, and even strengthening immune responses to disease. This should not be used as a tool to mask or ignore underlying causes of conditions like depression or anxiety. Instead, therapists use this phenomenon as a tool to temporarily improve moods in patients, so they have more strength to tackle the underlying issues involved. and brain hackers sometimes use it to help their kids finish their homework. Friendly note to men. Smiling may be good for the brain, but telling a woman you don't know to smile may not go over well. I challenged Lex to race me around the kitchen amid protests from my better half. It only took 3 laps to get the result. Clear head and no fidgeting. Not only does a little physical exercise balance the brain, but it's also great for ADHD. Take a walk, brain hack. The brain is the most powerful computer with the worst battery. We can go from a deep flow state of focus and clarity to feeling clumsy and forgetful in minutes. The brain could be the most complex thing in the known universe, but we can't tap into the power of that tool without understanding how it runs. You will learn later in this book how quickly our brains run out of focus power. This is a feature, and not a bug, in the system. The brain takes a lot of energy to function, so it is perfectly tuned for short moments of extreme challenge and long periods of leisure, much like we would find if we lived in the wild. Just thinking about a difficult subject can raise serotonin and glutamate, according to multiple studies, thus triggering sleepiness. That means, oddly, that thinking hard can make it difficult to continue to think hard. But there is a simple hack. Move. Serotonin binds with oxygen, so any aerobic exercise will clear it out of the brain. Glutamate and other byproducts of overthinking also balance out when we exercise. This is where we get the age-old phrase, "I took a walk to clear my head." Chapter summary. The smile brain hack. Every mental state has a corresponding physical expression. We smile and laugh when happy, stand tall when confident, and look down and hunch our shoulders when sad. By adopting one of these physical shapes, we can affect our mental state. Laughter therapy has become popular because of this. Take a walk brain hack. When we enter a mental challenge like a study session, our brain chemistry is balanced. Cognitive work throws this out of balance. The good news is that even light aerobic movement, like walking, rebalances the brain, quickly clearing your head and allowing you to get back to the task refreshed. Many great thinkers take afternoon walks to improve performance. 2. The Tale of Two Breaths. Back at the table, I ask my son, "Quick quiz, Lex. Can you remember the names of the planets?" Of course, I already knew that he could. He loved the hard sciences. But he didn't look confident. He wasn't quite over the crying session. And I could see that my question was making him nervous about making another mistake. Sometimes I forget how much little things feel like the end of the world to kids. I changed tack. "Okay, we just did the smile and take a walk brain hacks. But to get the best memory recall, let's do one more body brain hack." "Yes," he beamed, excited to learn my secrets. There are two nervous systems in the body, the automatic and autonomic, also called the sympathetic and parasympathetic, or simply the subconscious and conscious. Nearly every part of our body has picked a side of this system. When you think of lifting your hand, it goes up. Think about moving your feet, and they move. But parts like your heart, sweat glands, blood vessels, and even your pupils, when they dilate, for example, are run by the subconscious system. This is great because your heart will keep beating without any effort from you. But one organ is a double agent, your lungs. They will expand and contract exactly to your wishes. But when you don't think about it, your brain takes over and makes sure you keep breathing. Also, a good thing. So, by controlling your breathing, you can tell your body's subconscious system to act in different ways. This is the reason the lungs are a special tool in the mind-body connection. Slow your breathing, and you relax. Speed it up, and you stress out. With practice, you can essentially turn your stress and relaxation responses off and on. If you want to know why, the reason is as old as nature. When humans were just nomadic hunters, exposed to the wild, they had to develop ways to trigger their stress reaction to danger. Think about what people look like when they are surprised or scared. You probably imagine them opening their mouth and taking in a big gulp of air, and even lifting their elbows away from their body to maximize lung capacity. This reaction prepares them for the fight that will come soon. In the same way, if we breathe quick, short breaths, we are essentially telling our body to freak out. The stress response makes your chest move up and down, and you become temporarily numb from blood rushing away from the brain to the vital organs and muscles, in preparation for the fight-or-flight reaction to come. So if you panic on test-taking day, you will score well below your potential, simply because your body thinks this test is actually a tiger about to eat you. Even if there is no direct danger, the body still tries to prepare for a fight. So, if we can trigger stress, can we also trigger relaxation? Yes. I told Lex about the two different body systems, and we did an exercise to feel the difference. We placed one hand on our chest and the other on our stomach. After a few minutes, it was clear he was breathing with his chest and getting more and more stressed. After closing his eyes to focus, his chest slowed down and stopped as the stomach took over movement. 3 breaths later, he opened his eyes and smiled confidently. "Okay, starting from the sun," he began excitedly reciting the planets, waving his hands like a conductor greeting his orchestra. "Mercury, Venus, Earth, Mars, the asteroid belt, Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus." He pronounced Uranus exactly how you'd imagine a 6-year-old would. "And..." He stopped. "Stumped. I don't remember." A hint of disappointment crossed his face. Needing to keep him positive, I pulled out my final and favorite body brain hack. "Look up, Lex," I suggested, as I looked up myself. "When we forget something, we tend to look down because it stresses us out. But our memory works better when we look up. So looking up then sends more energy to the cerebral cortex," I geek explained to Lex. While absorbing this information, he looked up at the ceiling while asking himself what came after Uranus. Moments later, a large smile returned to his face. "Neptune, and the Kuiper Belt, and Pluto," added my wife, Dre, with a smile. "That's not a planet anymore, Mommy," rebutted Lex, wagging a finger at her. My wife just shrugged. "I grew up with Pluto on the list, and it will always be a planet to me," she replied, matter-of-factly. "Well then, Eris from the Kuiper Belt would be a planet too, because it's just about as big," he replied, turning to me with a big grin, "and I didn't even have to look up to know that." I laughed. Lex thought for a moment, thinking of a question. "Daddy, tell me what the eye in the breathing trick is called." "It's called a brain hack," I explained, looking into his curious eyes. "It's a technique or a way of thinking that gives us a mental ability we didn't have before. Just about anything you could want to do with your brain can be improved with brain hacks." He jumped into my arms unprompted, saying, "I want to learn all the brain hacks, Daddy." I paused, enjoying the hug. "I was just like you, Lex," I continued, hugging him tighter. "I do the same thing with the letters, reversing them, and I also had difficulty concentrating without fidgeting, just like you do. But I went on a quest to learn all the brain hacks to turn these problems into extra abilities." "Daddy is superhuman, Mommy," he exclaimed, quoting the TV competition that I'd won. I remembered the pride on his face when he saw me win the grand prize of $50,000 by memorizing binary code in seconds on the Fox show Superhuman. "You can use brain hacks to get amazing powers," I said, knowing that his favorite topic was superheroes. This did the trick, and Lex pulled back, looking deep into my eyes. "Like superpowers?" "In a way. For example, you might have the same brain wiring as me," I told him. "It can make it difficult to learn at first, but I'll teach you the brain hacks that I know, which can turn those disadvantages into superpowers." Lex grinned with excitement. "How did you learn these brain hacks?"
Teach me!
I had his attention. Now it was time to tell him my story. It was the story of how I turned my biggest challenge into an advantage, and in time, helped thousands of others in the same position. I was 14 years old, and it all started with one small piece of paper. That piece of paper changed my life. Baby Breath Brain Hack. Think of how a relaxed baby sleeps. I remember seeing my sleeping child's stomach moving in and out like a balloon while his chest was frozen in place. That's the secret. Chest breathing, when your chest moves up and down, supports the stress response. And belly breathing, when your stomach moves in and out, triggers calm. Step 1. Put one hand on your chest and the other on your stomach. Step 2. Breathe while noticing which hand moves the most. Step 3. Breathe so the top hand is motionless and the stomach hand moves the most. Take deeper and deeper breaths and make it a habit. Train your body to react to stress with relaxation. Look up Brain Hack. Everyone has had an experience where, by instinct, our eyes point to the sky when asked a question. This doesn't mean the memory was written in the clouds. It's just our natural reaction when trying to recall a memory. However, in moments when we're put on the spot, our mind blanks out, and a stress trigger is sent to our brain, which subsequently causes us to look down. My theory is that recall was difficult for our brains earlier in our evolution, so we started looking up to block out distractions. Chapter Summary. With the Baby Breath Brain Hack, we breathe with our stomachs, like babies, and that triggers relaxation. When we breathe with our chest moving, our brain stresses out more. No one knows why it happens, just that the look-up Brain Hack seems to direct more energy to the memory centers of the brain and improves recall, according to fMRI, functional MRI, studies. Axiom 2. Visualization. The brain is sitting in the dark, painting pictures in our imagination, using the paint of our senses. All the data from our senses is organized and contributes to this image we think is real. This mechanism also goes in the other direction. By properly visualizing things in our mind's eye, we can influence the brain to react as if something is really happening. 3. Where did I put my keys? On some level, we can't tell the difference between what is real and imagined. Attributed to Socrates, as told by Harry Lorraine. The teacher was reading my assessment results on a little slip of paper as the class rolled in. It was the result of one confusing day of testing with a professional to determine if I had learning disabilities. They didn't let me read it yet, but I knew, based on what people said, that I was ADHD and dyslexic, with hearing problems to boot. After reading this paper, each teacher treated me differently, and not always for the better. Instead of helping me overcome my challenges, it felt like this knowledge lowered the amount of their time I was worth. I felt like a lost cause and needed to get motivated. But motivation doesn't always come from inspiration or a supportive mentor. I wish that was my story, but my motivation came in the form of a bastard. My most hated high school class was easy. Too easy. "All right, everybody, listen," Mr. Ross said to the class. "I want to help bring your grades up, but you have to hand something in so I can justify giving you a mark. So just color in these maps, people." We were just a month into geography class when it became a coloring and crafts exercise. "This isn't learning," Becky, a normally quiet girl, said. "I can't believe we're doing this." "Shut up," scolded Mark, the boy sitting beside her. "Do you want him to give us something hard? Just fill it in and we get A's." Becky protested louder this time. "So this class just started, and you already think we're all failures?" Others murmured in agreement. "What's the matter with all of you?" Mr. Ross said, now addressing all the dissenters. "You're in the general level. I'm just trying to make sure you graduate someday. I could barely keep my eyes open because of the mind-numbing boredom of the class. Later, I discovered that those with ADHD need challenges. The worst thing you can do for an ADHD mind is make things easy. We lose all motivation. Our biggest struggle is internal, getting our brain to care. And we don't care when the stakes are low. Right as I nearly drifted to sleep for the second time, I slipped my hands into my pockets and realized the key to my bike lock was missing. For the past 2 weeks, I had lost my key nearly every day. I would leave it in a different place each time, another common ADHD trait. I tried putting it on a necklace or a bracelet, but the string broke. So instead, I tried something else. Humans are storytelling creatures because we are visualizing creatures. When someone tells a story, real or fictional, our brain plays it out, at least in part, in our imagination. This is a survival mechanism that allows us to pass on complex information and experiences to others without the same risk. Because we don't just imagine it either, we experience it. We suspend disbelief and play out the story as if it's happening to us. This is why we can cry, laugh, or even get scared during a movie. We know it's all made up, but our brain thinks it's real. The same mechanism allows us to hack the brain by visualizing anything we want the brain to believe is real. And we can improve our memory by visualizing the unforgettable. Exploding Keys Brain Hack. The key to remembering where you left something is to imagine a very memorable image the second you set down an object. My favorite was to imagine my keys exploding. After a while, I got into the habit of doing this, and it became second nature. I would set down my stuff and imagine a grenade under it that just made it all go flying across the room. This image would stick even after a long day. The minute I think of these items, the crazy explosion is the first thing that comes to mind, and I recall where I put them. After realizing my key was missing, I escaped the boredom of the class by diving into my imagination exercise. I thought about my key exploding and took a couple deep breaths. I realized I had set it down in the bathroom for some reason. The location was as clear as day to me, and this time, the exploding image jumped into my mind so fast it shocked me, and I let out a noise. "What's the matter with you, David? Are you stupid?" Mr. Ross said, right to my face. His blunt question woke me from my trance, and I fixated like a deer in headlights. The entire class stopped and looked at me, and I felt the room spin a bit from embarrassment. "I'm giving you an easy A. Just take it," he said. Finally, I spoke up. "I can't focus or even keep my eyes open with this stuff," I answered. "I want to learn things that will help me achieve my goals."
"And what are your goals?" Ross asked, with a chuckle.
"I want to run a business, speak on stages, and maybe get into technology and marketing." I was obsessed with marketing from late-night infomercials. My friend Scott's dad had a large collection of infomercial programs, from Tony Robbins to Dale Carnegie. I loved going through them. This was where I first learned memory techniques, and this love made me obsessed with how the programs were marketed. Still open to possibilities, I asked him, "Can we do something useful like learn flags or the names of countries and capitals?" To my surprise, several others nodded in approval of this tougher curriculum.
"I read your file, David," referring to my recent diagnosis, "and I know you can't focus. Your ADHD and dyslexia mean you're not going to run a business. You're probably a kinesthetic learner, too. You're not going to work in marketing or technology. I'm just trying to help you graduate. You need to lower your expectations."
My throat tightened up. No words could escape.
"And Becky, what's wrong with you? I mean it. Are you all stupid?" he said, looking around. "You're already in the general level. That's why I'm making it easy for you. I'm the good guy here. If you aim too high in life, you'll just be disappointed. Just color this in, and I can give you extra credit to help you pass this year." I looked around, judging that about half of the students were smiling like they were getting away with murder. Maybe they struggled in other classes and finally had a way to boost their grades. But the other half were sunk deep into their desks, not laughing or smiling. When a teacher treats you like you're unteachable, they send a message. You're not worth it. The biggest mistake I made was believing it. Chapter summary. Visualization principle. On some level, your brain can't tell the difference between what is real and imagined. This is why you can cry at a movie, even though you know that broke character on the screen is actually an actor, making millions for their role. To memorize an item's location, try the exploding keys brain hack. Imagine something crazy happening to it as you set it down. It can grow tall, come to life, be frozen in a block of ice, or, my favorite, explode. I tested this at McGill University, in association with the National Research Council of Canada, in a double-blind neuroscience study. It showed near-perfect recall among the group that used the technique properly. So, if you love it, blow it up. 4. Memorable journeys. After school that day, I went home and cried. I'm not ashamed to admit it. I bawled, alone in my room for what felt like hours. I had been pigeonholed by the system, categorized into a stream that didn't fit me. I was told my brain was wrong, that I was broken, stupid, useless. That every instinct and desire I showed to improve myself was either misguided or dangerous. Wanting a distraction, I headed downstairs to my dad's workshop. He was hunched over an open VCR, with an ohm meter in one hand, and the smell of ozone in the air. Our basement looked like a Steve Wozniak garage sale, filled with stacks of TVs, VCRs, and the exciting new devices, known as personal computers. But this wasn't a hobby. It was a side business that helped make ends meet. Even with no formal education in this area, he had mastered the ability to fix electronics, literally turning trash into cash. He would pick up broken TVs and appliances left out on the curb and fix them. The real genius was how he could work his magic on machines from completely different manufacturers. In those days when something was broken, people would say it blew out because the device often gave off a burning smell that came from a burnt-out resistor or capacitor. The way appliances were built back then, a resistor would literally get so hot, it would catch fire for a second, breaking its connection, and leaving a small black mark on the circuit board. My dad would simply look for the black mark and try to figure out which component was required to replace it. 1 2-cent resistor later, and he could resell that TV. With computers, the concept was almost the same. However, instead of resistors, it was integrated circuit, IC, chips. Back then, the computers would often fail when one of these chips got too hot. So he would identify the broken chip by using freeze spray to cool them, one at a time, until the computer booted up again. Then he'd replace the broken chip. This was the mindset that I was taught growing up. If something didn't work, we needed to figure out the problem ourselves. All it took was patience and logic. When I was 7, I wanted to learn about computers, but we were well below the poverty line and could never afford one ourselves. This was in 1984, when the Apple II was still a top-of-the-line product. So instead of buying one, we built our first computer using Steve Wozniak's design and the electronics lovers community. At that point, even though a new computer was too expensive, every component we needed to create one could be found in local flea markets and swap meets. Once we had all the parts together, we mounted this apple on a piece of plywood and called it a banana, just to think different. By the time I was 12, I had figured out the software part by installing a disk operating system, or DOS, and teaching myself basic programming. From there, I made my own Zork-inspired text-based adventure game. By the end of elementary school, I was a programmer, who could assemble electronics. I'd learned early on that our brains were our survival tools. And that night, tears drying on my face as I watched my dad perform another miracle, using nothing but his wits and logic, I realized I was like the TV in front of him. My diagnosis meant that I was broken to some. I was given up on and labeled as flawed. But I still contained all the components to work perfectly. I just needed to get in there and fix it. I started by taking the exploding keys brain hack technique further. The journey brain hack. To remember where you placed your keys, you can imagine them exploding. But why stop at one item? We can expand on this idea to memorize many items, even hundreds. Here is a list of random objects. Thermometer, statue, rock, chocolate bar, juice, chair, rain, tuning fork, cereal, dog, butler, mac and cheese. Many use repetition to memorize information, but often, repeating information over and over, rote memory, leads to recall that is full of errors and fades quickly. With practice, memory techniques can be nearly error-free, fun, and quick, and can lead to understanding the material and not just being able to regurgitate it. This particular method has a long history, alternately called the Roman Room Method, the Method of Loci, or the Memory Palace. Emperors and kings used it to learn and remember everything needed to be a head of state. To memorize a list in order, pick a room in your house or workplace that you are familiar with, a place you could close your eyes and visualize clearly. You will place these objects around your mental room in order, just like you did by visualizing the keys exploding. I make rules about what direction I will mentally travel around the room. I go from top to bottom and left to right. This means if I have a light switch above a nightstand with a lamp and a clock on it, then a window beside it, the order of my list would be light switch, lamp, clock, top drawer of the nightstand, under the nightstand, the curtain rod, window, windowsill, and so forth. This lets me take any room and make a linear list out of it. Here's an example using the list above and my room. 1. Imagine you stab the thermometer into the light switch and mercury drips down, causing sparks. 2. A Greek statue crushed the lamp. 3. The clock turns into a rock, still displaying the time. 4. There are a ton of melting chocolate bars in the top drawer, dripping down the nightstand. 5. You dropped your juice on the floor and it splashed under the nightstand. Now you try. Use a room in your house and do the same exercise, but make links that appeal to you. Practice this on a few lists until it's second nature. Use it for to-do lists, studying, or just for staying sharp. Oh, and the list I just gave you isn't a random list of objects, but actually, the way I taught my son to recall the planets in the solar system. Thermometer, Mercury, statue, Venus, rock, Earth, chocolate bars, Mars, juice, Jupiter, chair, Saturn, Saturn, rain, Uranus, Uranus, tuning fork, Neptune, Neptune, cereal, Ceres, largest object in the asteroid belt and a dwarf planet, dog, Pluto, butler, Haumea, pronounced Haumea, how may I help you, macaroni and cheese, make make. There is a carry-on effect when memorizing information with memory techniques rather than just repetition. Rote memory focuses only on the list or phrase we are repeating over and over to memorize and also fade quickly. But memory techniques give us more power by giving our brain a fuller picture. When you link information using these techniques, other details come along for the ride. For example, when you link a person's name to their face, you will start to recall other things too, like details of your conversations and other preferences they shared with you. This extra understanding comes from an interesting natural effect when stimulating your memory. When you make a connection using visualization in the right way, you activate the reticular activating system, RAS. This opens up your brain's long-term memory, and in the process, other information comes along for the ride when you link it. You can be memorizing the names of generals in a war, and in the process, information like the battle's turning point gets connected too. I decided that night to take charge of my brain and learn everything I could about how to hack it, leaving no stone unturned. I would search for real-world hacks through books on memory, speed learning, speed reading, neuroscience, and even mentalism, hypnosis, and much more. All along the way, I would experiment with what I learned, trying new ways to apply these techniques, and even invent new ones. When I was ready, I would teach others. Chapter Summary. When you want to remember items on a list, try the Journey Brain Hack to go beyond what is possible with rote memorization. Step 1. Choose a room or series of rooms to use as your mental journey. Make sure you are already familiar with the layout of the room. Step 2. Go around the room from top to bottom, then left to right, linking an object to each location. Step 3. Review a couple of times, just to make sure you didn't make a mistake. 5. Pain Hack, Brain Hack. The next day, I left for school late, riding recklessly and weaving my bike around, often against traffic. A horn sounded as tires screeched to a halt. I swerved, trying to avoid doing a discount Evel Knievel impression. "Focus," I chanted to myself, ignoring my pounding heart. Yes, it was my fault that I was late for school. For others, being late only meant two things: laziness and unreliability. My ADHD made me lose track of time or distracted me. But the worst thing about the morning was the pain. I have woken up each day with back pain for as far back as I can remember. So jumping out of bed to race to school was impossible. Anyone with chronic pain knows that there are good days and bad. On my good days, I could run and play with just as much zeal as my peers. But on bad days, I'd remember just how much of a cage my body was. Sometimes adults would use my good days as proof that I was faking my bad days. That day on my bike was a bad day, so I packed a fold-away cane in my backpack, just in case I needed it. Not only was I late to school, I was also late to a meeting with the principal. Rushing into the main office, cane in hand, I saw a row of secretaries sitting along a long counter. Their constant chatter and shuffling of papers reminded me of crows on a power line. Noticing I had come to the meeting without my parents, the paper mavens stopped their endless sorting of forms and looked up at me with a knowing expression. They'd seen me before. Their problem kid radar was in full effect, and they knew I was going to be a regular visitor. Being a 14-year-old kid walking with a cane had its pros and cons. Kids would make fun of me, of course, but they'd do it from a distance, as I did have a metal stick at my side. However, it was the adults' reactions that affected me the most. "You're not allowed to bring that with you," I looked up as one maven pointed at my cane. "It can be used as a weapon," she continued. "The only thing this fights is gravity," I joked, trying to lighten the mood. But the paper maven was ready to fight for her just belief. "I remember you from earlier. You didn't need a cane to walk," she retorted, her voice raising with each word. "So stop faking for sympathy and hand it over." The noisy paper coop suddenly fell silent. Everyone's eyes turned to the problem kid as they waited to see my next move. Sadly, I did the worst thing imaginable. I complied. As I surrendered my cane, my explanations of my pains coming and going fell on deaf ears. I decided to sit and escape into my imagination. They call it daydreaming, but it helped me. From the day I was born, doctors said I was going to die. I was hospitalized for the first 11 weeks of life. And I'm told the doctors were right. I did die, twice. But the angels in uniform performed their miracles and brought me back. I was in and out of the hospital for years, dealing with chronic pain, sickness, breathing issues, and more. But the worst for me was the boredom. To stay sane as a child back in the hospital, with nothing to entertain me but my thoughts, I would create elaborate stories and construct amazing machines in my mind. At the time, I didn't realize I was using the principle of visualization. I was just trying to use my mind to stop my pain. My years of hospital boredom had been a training ground. One trick I learned was how to fool my senses. I would stand up and put my feet together. Then I'd imagine I was on top of a building. I would ask myself questions and really sink deep into the image, make it feel real, then mentally walk to the edge and jump off. With practice, I got better and better, until I felt a powerful reaction in my body as strong as riding a roller coaster, and was able to feel the sensation of flying. Try it yourself. Many brain hacks use visualization, but that word is about more than just the visual sense. When you imagine a hack, you should be using all of your senses to create a realistic scene in your mind's eye. Use the word visualization, but in reality, this process uses all your senses. I want to call it sensualization, but that word sounds like it should be in a romance novel instead.
"The principal will see you now,"
the maven said in a monotone voice, handing me the paper that all my teachers had already seen. "Student Dave Farrow shows signs of dyslexia, ADD, ADHD, and slow learning, even with a high IQ. Medical concerns include dizzy spells, fatigue, and complaints of chronic pain." I remained seated, rereading the paper repeatedly. Yes, I'll admit that I did have difficulty focusing and could get distracted faster than a dog in a room full of squirrels. But I could learn quickly, too. I just fell behind because of medical problems and couldn't figure out how to catch up. I also blanked out on tests, even when I really knew the information. The chronic pain was normal to me by now, though, so I had no idea how much it was hurting my grades. As for the dyslexia, yes, I knew that letters did weird things when I read them too fast. It made spelling nearly impossible, but I still read well, just slowly. Then I got really upset fixating on the word complaints. They'd put quotes around it. Did that imply it was a fake? I had my medical records and doctor's notes. Why was it so hard to believe a kid had back pain? Bang! The sound of a paper maven hitting the counter shook me out of my thoughts. "I said, the principal will see you now," she yelled. I'd unintentionally hyper-focused on the page. If only I could hyper-focus on my studies, I'd be Superman, I thought. I didn't realize it would be true one day. Murphy must have been smiling because his law was in full effect. In that very moment as I got up, a terrible pain shot from my back down my leg. I held back the tears, refusing to collapse and earn more words of discouragement from the mavens as I took one painful step at a time. 10 painful jabs until I reached the chair in his office, I thought. It was 12. As I entered Principal James's office, he gestured for me to sit and wait while he continued talking on the phone. That was good, because I needed a few minutes to do another brain hack. It was a trick that I'd developed in the hospital while dealing with my chronic pain. As a child, I'd have bouts of pain and was medicated accordingly. One day, they stopped my meds out of fear of me developing an addiction. The problem with pain is that it's invisible. You never know what someone is dealing with by looking from the outside. My pain led to depression, sleep problems, and poor academic performance. Addiction seemed equally horrible too, so I seemed to be stuck in a catch-22. During those days when the pain was unbearable, and the only tool I had was my imagination. I developed a brain hack to push away the pain. Later in life, I taught this technique in my courses and freed people from years of pain. It was a combination of visualization and breathing. When done right, it allowed me to completely block out the sensation of pain. All I needed was a moment to concentrate. Push Away Pain Brain Hack. Millions of Americans suffer from migraines, joint pain, and fibromyalgia, and pain is considered the fifth vital sign in medicine, akin to one's heart rate and blood pressure. Pain is our body's way of telling us something is wrong. But what happens when the signal becomes the disease? My process takes advantage of a natural visualization mechanism in the brain. In this way, we can change how our bodies perceive information, allowing us to mitigate pain. But like any tool, it can be used incorrectly. Follow these steps to get the most out of the pain hack. Step 1. Visualize the area in pain. Imagine every muscle, ligament, bone, organ, and/or nerve cell. Try to imagine it as clearly as possible, not in your mind's eye, but as if you're looking through a scanner right into your body. Step 2. Slow your breathing and become aware of your breath and blood flow. Try to get into a state of total awareness, focusing on the area in pain and blocking out any outside distractions. Step 3. Let your body give you an image of the pain. Just be open to it, don't force it. Ask your body to show you what the pain looks like, and accept any visual representation it shows you. When I first tried this technique, I visualized my pain as rust-red-colored dust swirling around the pain point. But others have told me they see something else. The key is to imagine what your brain thinks the pain looks like. Don't push your ideas onto it. Step 4. Take deep breaths in, and as you exhale, imagine your breath is pushing on the pain. Watch the pain as it's slowly blown away by the wind your breath is causing. Don't rush or push too hard at first. Take your time, and let it happen over the course of several breaths. This is similar to meditation, but it's unnecessary to take much time, go deep, or get into a trance. Just use your imagination. You should feel the pain lifting naturally. There is one downside to this pain hack. To keep the pain away, you need to keep focusing. It doesn't require as much focus as it took to banish the pain in the first place. But if you want to keep the pain away, you need to keep visualizing your breath pushing at it, or it will return. I have used this technique many times to push powerful pain away in order to drift off to sleep, only for it to return at the last moment. Chapter Summary. My Push Away Pain Brain Hack is a visualization trick meant to fool the senses. All you need to do is imagine the area in pain. Let your mind tell you what the pain looks like. Breathe deeply and imagine the breath as a wind blowing at it. Relax and let it go. 6. Hack to the Future. Back in the principal's office, with a few deep breaths, my pain was almost gone. As I looked up, I saw him staring at me.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.